decapitated head of a voodoo doll. It'll be fully quilted out. You see me do my stitch work. I'll add some torn elements where it's torn off. And you can ask questions as I go, if you'd like. To start out, all my quilting is done over a layer of silver string. It just backs up because I'm drawing all my little quilt sections on a stringer. The silver string like opaques up the background, and like if it's blowing out and any of the colors are thinning out a little bit, that gives it a nice background to keep it dense. Don't get any transparent spots. So I try to shoot for like an organized chaos in my patches. Keep track of what colors are next to each other so they don't look too similar and get nice contrasts. Yeah, I worked in a hot shop. I started in 99 in a factory making snowmen with a team, and then was fortunate enough to be in the Western Massachusetts, where there were a ton of soft glass blowers and furnaces going who needed help. And so for probably 8 years, I worked for several glass artists all around. My work week was bouncing around. I'd work on goblets one day and paperweights another day. It was really a great way to learn. And then I'd rent every weekend or any minute I could to make my own work. I definitely got that bug. I have not stopped. And it's been great transitioning because I feel like I've been able to start that learning curve all over. Like with flame working, it's been like, I'm still feeling like I'm learning. I have so much more to learn. And it's kind of very pleasurable. All right, so I'll go with Person Strike is going to be my first little square. So I usually just draw on my shape and then fill it in as I go. So I did craft shows with my furnace works class up and down the east coast of the country for years, probably like 13 years. And along the way, I made friends with a flame worker who was doing those same shows, Joe Peters. So we started sharing a van and traveling together to cut down on some of our expenses, and we liked hanging out. Both liked to smoke weed. Travel up and down the coast, and finally got to the point where doing so much collaborative work, he moved into my studio space, where we put together soft glass blown vessels, and we hexed all different borosilicate sculptures within those pieces. And having him move in right on my doorstep with all those tools and the torches set up, I just couldn't stay away. During that period that he started making functional work. And collaboration is such a big thing in the pipe world. That first 2 years I was flame working and trying to figure out my thing, so many great flame workers came through to collaborate with Joe. I just had just like my soft glass experience in the Boro world, I got exposed to a lot of different techniques and a lot of approaches right away. Now I'm porting in gray here. My entire palette here is glass alchemy. Not used to the wind factor. So to achieve my look of stitched fabric, all the color really has to be right on the surface. for the stitches to look real. If there's a clear encasement, it casts a shadow on the stitch and it kind of breaks the element, like that realistic look. So I try to choose a pretty workable palette. My red I use is Persimmon Strike, so I can really cook it and I'm not worried about burning out any cadmiums or anything. I do add some cadmiums to my palette, usually with compressed air. I won't put any in today.
What kind of pattern are you applying?
What's that?
What's the pattern?
Here, let me put this on and I'll bring it right out there and show you a little of this. I'm making little squares of each color so that it will look like quilt sections.
Okay, like a non-square.
Little triangles on the end, but it will be squares down the
side.
Okay. Starting from the end there, and now I'll make squares down the sidewall of this.
Sure.
Staggering my seams to make it nice and quilt-like. Well, I was always very inspired by stop-motion animation and a lot of the creations of Tim Burton and some of his stop-motion animation films. And one thing that I was always really into was, I don't know if you've seen Nightmare Before Christmas, but Sally's dress, for some reason, the way it was patchwork stitched. Always loved that look and wanted to see if I could apply it to glass. It never quite captured in the soft glass, but when I started transitioning and, you know, it didn't matter what I made, I just started out trying to achieve that. Just kind of lucked out that nobody else was doing that, and I really got attributed to me really quickly. I keep trying to push to find ways to apply it. I missed the spot. And then, of course, all my work sandblasted in the end to really give it that cloth effect. Mint. All the colors work well together. Find it's very consistent. I don't really get it.
I find a lot of artists like to pick a palette and stick with it. I don't. I try new stuff all the time and it doesn't work.
I like to integrate new colors to my palette. Sometimes it's tricky though. Like, a lot of pastel-y colors that are out right now that I haven't really figured out how to make them work with my aesthetic. I try to avoid letting color trends dictate what I pick. I just pick what I like. For a while, the new transparents were becoming very popular, and obviously, like in a patchwork, I couldn't figure out how to make that fit in. So that's when I started developing the torn technique, where I'll encamo a transparent with an opaque, and then make it look like it's torn open, so that it looks like that skin is formed over the transparent. Just try to come up with creative ways to integrate some of the cool colors. But kind of try to keep it on my own terms. See, my colors look the same under this light for some reason.
Is that Solar Strike a powder or a video?
Okay. Size 72, fine. Basically, I'll quilt it, finish the quilt tubing, even out the wall weight, blow a form, sculpt it, and then when it's mostly sculpted, that's when I go back and add my stitches so they can stay nice and raised. I can avoid areas, like if I put a band-aid or something, I'll just stitch where there's negative space. Transitioning from working at a furnace shop where when I'd be doing my adjustments when I'd be working, there'd be an air knob and a gas knob. Two knobs. Basically two knobs here control everything. So it made sense to me. I get in front of a GTT and I'm kind of overwhelmed with the options of knobs to turn.
That's why I don't play video games anymore.
And I feel like it gets a nice core heat in the glass that sometimes I can make it feel like soft. It's getting a nice big bubble hot. I'll stretch a neck with my jacks and blow. do a lot of things I do at the furnace. I work on one baler most of the time.
Are there any techniques you found that do not translate to Aurora?
Well, I finished every piece for the first 6 months by punting a piece and opening the mouthpiece like on a punty, like I'd finish a soft glass piece.
Yeah.
And it took me a while to realize that was kind of ridiculous. Just hold on to it with a grabber and finish it and not have to clean the punty off again.
Or even your bare hand.
Yeah, I used the graphite pad for a while.
Brown.
I still trim a lot of lips with shears rather than. But one thing that is odd for me coming from a soft glass shop here is like using glass as a tool. I see so many glass blowers using their punties as ways to trim lips and stuff, but I'll just straight up pull with my tweezers and cut with my straight shears just like I did in the furniture shop.
I think why is there all this debris inside of my face?
You just gotta do it at the right temp and you're good.
I can't believe I didn't see that.
What's that?
What color?
This is chocolate brown, chocolate crayon. So I am using a little bit of crayon oil here, but it works. I knew Shelbo would take the mic. Probably do one more layer of quilts and then I'll be able to heat this thing up. This is a quick, fast overlay in the hot shop versus flame work. Hey, so much color prep. It's harder and harder as you go along to like make sure you don't overlap the same colors right next to each other. Get that contrast going.
Are you butting the colors together or leaving a tiny space?
Oh, right against each other. So oh, that when I go ahead and stitch together, it's perfectly seamless.
Oh, okay.
After I blow it out, I'll blow it out a little bit and even out, I'll show it all around.
Okay.
Like one of those maps where you have to use only so many colors to
get
all the, so right. They don't touch each other, right?
Exactly, that's exactly the exercise.
You have to think about what color thread you're going to use too in between each one so it stands out against both.
Almost always I use black. Specifically Eclipse is what I use for my thin strands because it pretty much contrasts everything. I think the only time I've used anything else is like on a black and gray piece I'll use white. So now I'll just start heating this up and get evened out a little bit. Different colors, sometimes it's a little bit of a wrestling job. There's the hot shop in me right there.
I've never seen anybody do that before.
And I'll use this as my yoke, like it's the bench as well, like when I'm pulling a neck. I pull against that and blow as I pull, and you can make like a neck base just like at the bench at Petersburg. Especially with this nice herby wood. I'll pull it out a little bit here, I'll pull it out a little. Now I got this bubble on. It's got all these little quilted sections on it. The livery color will strike out some nice red. Anybody else back there want me to walk around with it? I got a few more, like another minute. Trying to make it flat on the back, nice and rounded back out on the front. Head, just the head. Back a little bit more. And then I can start sculpting it up, adding stitches. First thing I'm going to do is add a seam around the outside of where the two halves would have been sewn together and bunched, and I do that with like a texture butter knife, so it leaves a little bit of that texture in as I carve it. Seams on bigger pieces are nice when I'm trying to do anything symmetrical because they supply this beautiful point of reference. For additions of any other arms, limbs, eyes, everything can be based on like those two lines down the center, two sides of the piece.
Exactly.
adding the features. See how the wind does with this tiny string. Lay the stringer down, and then I use a bent tungsten to finish the effect. I'll heat and grab each termination of my stringer line, and take it and drag it and press in, so it looks like it's sewn through. It's a real authentic look, realistic look. I'll be trying not trying to lose that texture of the string on the surface.
Just
before
you do the string.
Stringer on, and grabbing the edge, holding it around. Okay. And it helps, you know, it's melting into the surface a little bit more while I do this. But it really is the key to making it look stitched. Usually tend to make my guys a little bit sad. They're never really too stoked to be poked and prodded with the cart. I think there's two happy ones out there in all the years I made them. I collabed with one gentleman who's just such a happy dude, I could not put a sad face. And he's the one piece, like, he's ripping himself open and showing this Sven Glass's beautiful pattern within, and it's like, he's just offering himself rather than being poked and prodded.
He's accepted his
fate. Yeah. He's okay with it. A couple stitches across them.
Since you have a bottle of stringer there, do you just do stringer day every once in a while, or do you pull a little bit all the time?
Oh no, I dedicate time to get all this done so I don't have to stop in the middle of a piece and do it. That's what I did the day before I flew here, is I pulled stringer. Otherwise, yeah, I'd be boring you for 2 hours just to pull stringer.
Thank you.
The first demo I ever did, I got there and started pulling this, and I was realizing what a bad decision it was. Luckily, I was collaborating with two other artists, so there was more to watch on either side of me. Learn. Stitches in the eye all together, and then do those, and then make the indentation. I just kind of spaced out and didn't put the cross sections. I think it'll look a lot better with the cross sections. I don't have any like set rule or anything. I've kind of internalized the timing, you know. I jinx myself, but like I feel like I know now how long I can work it before I flash it and don't blow it up. But along my learning process, adopting this voodoo doll aesthetic ended up being a real nice thing, because as I'd have issues with color here and there or problems, I'd learned that like with a voodoo doll you can come up with these creative solutions to those problems. That's how I put my first band-aid on a piece over scummy looking bit of color. band-aids, patches, buttons. They can all cover up those like little funk that you get sometimes. All right, now I should decide what color button. I'm gonna go with a red button. Now, on a piece this small, I add the button right on now and keep working the piece. On my larger pieces, that button's the last thing to go on because I like just stick it on there, one stick and hit it, and then film it and then mount piece it so I can have that really nice edge that, again, makes it look more realistic. It's a little more sketchy, but it looks real. And it's easier to mask a button off with an edge than one that's like melted in. Sketchy little spot there. I'll just keep it warm the whole time and I should have no issues. Put the thread on the button. I'll put a band-aid on the back of his head too so you can see how I do that. Silver stripe is the perfect band-aid color. And sometimes because it's surface work, the silver stripe will fume off. I don't worry about that stuff because it's all going to get blasted off in the end.
You mean sandblasted?
Yep, I sandblasted. That's when my pieces come alive. They look cool when they come out of the kiln, but when they get masked up and glassed and they come out, that's when they have that.
What size grid do you use?
220. And then after it's blasted, I rub things down with oil to get rid of the chalky surface effect.
What oil do you use?
I actually use walnut oil, because I can pull it out of my fridge and eat it if I wanted to, and a lot of my pieces are going in people's mouths to smoke them, so I try to put something nice and edible. And also I can tell all my customers they can go to a Whole Foods and stick a jar in their fridge, so when they do deep clean their pieces, they can restore that perfect finish brand new again. So that is one thing, when you're making a functional piece, people are cleaning it often. Well, hopefully. If they appreciate the flavor, they're cleaning it off.
What's the suggestion for the deep clean?
Isopropyl alcohol. You just soak it. I sometimes throw it in my kiln.
Right. Well, just buy a kiln from me and then you can deep clean it.
Alright, so I've made the shape for the band-aid. Now I'm going to add that little pad right in the middle. My inspiration does come a lot from film. It was only recently, I just kind of make stuff. I don't overthink it, but sometimes you do, you know, I have an interview and you know you're gonna get asked questions about all kinds of stuff. And kind of traced it back to my first experience making art was hanging out at an uncle's house who babysat me, and he was an oil painter. It was the early, mid-80s, and what we do, and my brother and I go to his house, is we usually turn on like something like Star Wars, and he'd put out paper across the coffee table, and we'd kind of watch Star Wars, but also just be drawing like scenes. So that inspiration from film, I think, just carried over into the sculptural work as well. I don't often recreate specific characters. There's exceptions. I've done Edward Scissorhands and a few really fun projects that I've chosen to do, but mostly it's trying to create my own characters. So now I'll put some little dimples in the pad, that same bent kind of stuff. Stitches and all my features, and I'll show it to you. Now I need to work around all those features and stitch together all the exposed intersections of my original clothing. So you see the dimples really touching. And as I add the stitches over all the clothing sections, that's what I say. On my bigger pieces, the buttons are separate, and it's like one of the last things I do is do that.
Oh, okay.
It'll be so good. This I'm trying to keep warm. I'm not doing the best job. Looks like I just don't want to. Now I have to like be a little bit more conscious of that. Does anybody else want a closer look back there? Good. Now a bunch of stitches. Draw a bunch of them on and then on a section and then go back and pull that section my way around.
Ivory and the eyes are used for
questions? I can't believe I'm demoing it again. Anybody here go to Amsterdam for the gas conference? In like, one or two? I went. That was my first ultimate write-off. That was... Coffee shops and glass blowing. It was great. I was trying to imagine what it'd been like. They floated a barge and had everybody blowing glass in a barge in the canal. Must have added an exciting element.
Flames blowing, everyone staff where air pressure could be better than when the solid parts go on.
You have as hard a time as I did finding things in Amsterdam. Like, I kept getting lost. I'd show up for a lecture, like, just as it finished. My recreation probably didn't help.
That's a good chocolate
for this part of it. Oh, absolutely. I had chocolate for lunch over there. There's a bonbon place. That just, it was just a table with bonbons and a woman with some tongs. They were just amazing.
Lectures in English?
Yeah.
So.
Whoops.
It's fine. Everything's fine.
Will you marvering for the stitches, I guess?
What's that?
Marvering for the stitches?
Yeah. Marvering?
With your, putting the...
What I'm doing is I'm taking all the stringers I drew on, and I'm like heating the termination, and I'm taking it, stretching it, and pushing it in. That's what makes it so consistent.
Thank you.
Yeah, no worries. A couple more. I think I'm going to popsicle, so this is a wearable pendant as well. And then I'll flip it around and make it torn open with cotton spilling out of its neck where it got ripped.
Small.
I just put a little bead of clear in there so I can blow out the other hole easily and clean that back up. This is just how I do it. I don't know if it's how other people do it.
Sometimes you can actually blow the other holes.
Yeah. It's pretty thick in there. Straight tungsten and pull that back wall out a little bit so a cord can just kind of go through straight instead of the pain of hooking it around the corner. Two cotton color is star white. That's a nice star white. Thank you. I've got my cotton hanging down and I need to like add material of the same color at this edge. I'll turn that into the torn material where it's torn open. I'm gonna put this away for a minute and make a little needle that will stick in it somewhere as well. That there. It's green since there's no green in the piece yet. Tungsten bent tweezers is one of my other favorite tools. So the pin will go in one side of the head, and then I'm going to need a little tip coming out the other side of the head. So this is like a little material I can weld on here later.
I've never seen anybody use diamond shears on a rod.
Oh yeah, like when I make segments for arms and legs, I'll frit up a nice big section and then use my diamonds and divide up the sections I need, necking them down with my diamonds. So that's looking around. I'm just going to do the tier neck, time wise. This is always tricky to like tell the difference between aqua mist and mint. When it's hot, it's. So I just, if it was one color, I'd simply like coil pop right on that seam, but since they're individual, I'm going to make little gathers just to cover the edge of each patch. Gather, and immediately go in with a overlap of that color. Next one. Do is draw a little line on the back of the pendant so there's no like little flat hitting anybody's chest if they're wearing it. Torch and make sure that's welded on really nice before I actually manipulate it so it's here.
Sandblasting
is going to make it look so much more realistic.
Oh, yeah.
been behaving so far. Well, I'm going to stick one half of my pin on, and then I'll give you guys another chance to look at it. So to rough up the cotton, I'm just going to get in there and do some little twists and turns on the tweezers.
Yes.
Just pin them straight through the heads.
What color do you use for the pin?
Portland gray represents the metal, and then I have forest green as the head of my kiln. I meant to do that. I didn't mean to hurt myself. Just picked up the hot ends. Leather up those fingers a little bit more. Glad I burned myself at the end of my job. I think I'd be using the charm for that.
Do you need burn cream?
Afterwards. It's really surfacey. It's just going to turn into nice hard skin. Second class I ever taught was a class with students here and my torch here. That was my biggest burden. I was answering a question like that and just totally burning this from here to here right in my torch. I didn't pop it, no scars, but I got on a plane the next day and the added pressure of the plane, like, it was just like a football off the side
of the wow.
Side on. I'll give myself a little cheater spot so I know it lines up. Really conscious of good skills on these little guys.
I
you could flash here and give you one peek before I take it off. Anybody ever toasted marshmallows? My daughter, I do. It just like takes seconds. It's great. You gotta like stick them right on the glass. S'mores without having to make bars. And I love my finishing tools. These things are great. It's a lot easier than another punny and another punny. In the process of putting this little punny on, I kind of melted in a few of my stitch dimples, so I hit those really quickly before I put it away as well.
Hell yeah, thank you, man.
I think I touched on a little bit of everything that I was known for.
So,
thank you so much for coming out. I didn't expect such a big audience.